There's one peculiar form of punishment that ISIS adopts, which is this idea of throwing homosexuals out of high buildings. Where does that come from?
Certainly, there isn't anything in the Quran. The word homosexuality isn't actually even mentioned in the Quran. There is no punishment in the Quran for anybody who was homosexual. The last caliphate that we had was the Ottoman Empire. And in 1858, the Ottomans decriminalized homosexuality. But before that, it was criminal. And these scripts, or this justification, comes from some sayings of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, of for certain people. But what they've done is they've taken these sayings to mean everybody who's homosexual, not specific people who were causing certain problems at the time. And I think that we have this concept of jurisprudence, of fiqh, and fiqh changes along the ways. Wahhabis, Salafis, they Islamists, they don't want us to reform this fiqh, even though the last caliphate did. It's in these people's interest to take those previous rulings and use them.
O ataque na Flórida, portanto, se encaixa nesta doutrina e não surpreende que tenha recebido endosso do ISIS via declaração com referência a Ló, personagem da Bíblia e do Alcorão, enviado divino para confrontar a decadência de Sodoma e Gomorra. Em treinamento e na prática, os ideólogos do ISIS enfatizam trechos do Alcorão e da tradição oral do Islã que reforçam o uso da violência contra os adversários. O manual de selvageria diz que jihad, ou luta em nome da fé, não se baseia em perdão, e sim em violência retaliatória extrema.
Well, we're not dealing with the specifics of what happened in Orlando, but in any case, we're all getting the information from the media about the things that happened. A lot of things are still developing. What's your take on it?
A lot of people are using the term lone wolf. I'm fed up of people using that term. There is no such thing as a lone wolf jihadist terrorist. All the research that we've done, the research that every other experts have done, shows that every single jihadist has had contact with somebody and is part of a pack. He was not a lone wolf, he's what we call a self-starter. He had a pack around him, his parents, his family, he's struggling with his own sexuality and what everybody would have been telling him. A virtual pack online, if you like, people recruiting him. And for me, this person was a homophobe. This person may well have had some mental health issues, but ultimately, at the end of the day, this was an act of jihadist terrorism as part of the global jihadist insurgency. And that's what we're facing right now.
What leads a young Muslim born and raised and educated in a society such as Europe or in the US, with freedom of religion, of expression, what leads a person like that to commit an act of violence?
We look at the radicalization per se. Each person's journey is unique, but there are some common pathways. And the common pathways fit into three stages. The first stage is every single person in society, whether they're Muslim or not, at any given time has a problem, has a grievance. And these grievances can fit in three categories. Either a genuine grievance, that can be racism, that can be you can't get a job, that can be that you've fallen in love. The leader of the 7/7 bombers had a grievance. He fell in love. That's how he joined this group. He wanted to marry his girlfriend from university. His father wanted him to marry his cousin from Pakistan, who he didn't even know. He had a grievance. Then you can have partial grievances, and you can have perceived grievances. In the middle, you have charismatic recruiters. And what these charismatic recruiters are able to do is to say to people, we can provide you solutions to these problems, these grievances. And they say, in the case of Sadiq Khan, who was the leader of the 7/7 bombers, come and join our gang, we'll tell you what to say to your father so that he allows you to marry your girlfriend, who was also Muslim. And so they did, and he joined them. And then, but once you're in this gang, then certain people are then selected to go to the third stage, which essentially is the belief that they have to fight for this Islamic State and the theological justification that the only way they can be in this gang once they've joined this now is that God wants them to do it and God will reward them for doing it, and if they don't do it, God is not with them.
But the moment they get there and they spend some time with them and they see the brutality, they see the killings, is it happening that these people are saying, oops, I made a mistake?
There are a lot of, well, first of all, when somebody goes and joins them, the process is that they go to the land that's controlled by ISIS and they give what's called a bayah. That's an oath of allegiance. They then say that Baghdadi is their khalif and they will live under the rules. Then they're given two types of training. One is theological training, further theological indoctrination. And if you're a man as opposed to a woman, usually you're given a gun and some sort of training on firearms, etc. Once you have given this oath of allegiance, if you break that oath of allegiance, you're a traitor and you must be killed. That's the first thing. They don't allow people to defect and to change their mind. But there are people around the region, and there have been people in the region who have defected and left and come back to the UK and come back to the other countries. And those people actually that come back fit into three categories. The first one is some of them come back disillusioned. Some of them come back disturbed, because we have soldiers that suffer from stress. These are young kids, soldiers when they've been in a war zone. These are young kids in many cases. And they've come back and they are severely disturbed from an emotional and mental perspective. Then we have the third category, people who are still dangerous. And these are people who may have been disillusioned, but come back and haven't disavowed the whole ideology and theology. All three need to be tackled, and we are seeing more and more defections. But still, it's in ISIS theological narratives and beliefs that people aren't allowed to leave. Once you're in, you're in. That's it.